The objective today will be to describe what the Intel manual says about operand addressing. So in the last video, we talked about operand size and address size, but that was in a 32-bit system. So I wanted to cover the 64-bit system real quick, or I should say 64-bit mode real quick, because that's going to use a whole nother flag, the L flag, instead of that D flag. And then I'll be able to scroll down to page 83, well, the bottom of page 83, section 3.7, to really hammer down operand addressing. All right, so the first thing I noticed was maybe some confusion on my own part about canonical addressing, what that actually means. As a review here, canonical is just the use of less than 64 bits in an address. The first sentence here, in 64-bit mode, the default address size is 64 bits and the default operand size is 32 bits. That's the first sentence saying that address sizes are 64 when it's in the 64-bit mode. However, as we learned about canonical addressing, we walked away with the knowledge that most computers are not implementing all 64 bits. You'll see maybe 48 or 54-bit implementations. And for something to be canonical, it simply needs bit 47 to be the same all the way down. So remember, 64 bits is really large. So every bit from 47 down would need to be either on or off for it to be considered a canonical address. So this sentence doesn't like violate my knowledge or our knowledge of canonical addressing. It just reminds us that it may be 64 bits, but not every bit will be used. If I scroll down here, we can look at this picture. This is very clearly more than 32 bits in an address. So one, let's go down to a number with more variety here. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bytes right here. So the only way for this program, this ELF, to be running is if it's in 64-bit mode. Alright, so when in 64-bit mode, operands are only going to take up 32 bits, but the addresses by default will be 64. The manual later says defaults can be overridden using prefixes. Address size and operand size prefixes allow mixing of 32, 64-bit data, and the same for addresses on an instruction-by-instruction basis. And for a second question, based on this second sentence, well, third sentence, my bad, what if I said, what can be applied on an instruction-by-instruction basis? And the answer is a prefix, right there, a prefix that will determine the size of an address and operand. So what is that prefix, you ask? Table 3.4, whoops, I clicked it, so table 3.4 shows valid combinations of the 66H instruction prefix. So the number 66 in hexadecimal is the prefix. And the other one is REX.W. And you're using these to specify operand size overrides in 64-bit mode. So what was the default size of the operand in 64-bit mode? 32. So there's that exact question right there. Follow-up question, what prefix would you use to increase operand size? And if we go down to the table, we see that right there, operand size prefix 66H. And it looks like this REX.W prefix just exists so you can mix and match different sizes for your effective operand and address size. So if we look for a pattern down here, 32 and 64, 32 and 32, 16 and 64, 16 and 32, then two 64s, 64, 32, another set of two 64s. So the way we can get this would be with a 1 for the prefix, a yes for that prefix, and then on the address prefix, just a no. This same combination will give us the same result as if we did this combination of a 1 and two n's. So maybe there's the shortcut. Use REX.W prefix to get operand and address sizes of 64. So the answer to that question, a little tricky, what prefix would you use? You could use either REX.W, which REX.W always makes me think of this picture of like a T-Rex riding like REX.W, or you could use 66H. Well, I mean 66 in hexadecimal. You can use that just to change the size of your operands. And really quick reminder, an operand is a value, and an operator is the action being taken on that value. So if I did 1 plus 3, the 3 and the 1 are operands, and the plus is the operator. Okay, well it says that, note that 16-bit addresses are not supported in 64-bit mode. Now, REX prefixes consist of 4-bit fields that form 16 different values. So there's my picture of 4 bits. Ones and zeros are the values that can fit into there, right? Well, that's the REX prefix. Now, the W bit field in the REX prefix is referred to as REX.W. If the REX.W field is properly set, the prefix specifies an operand size override to 64 bits. Note that software can still use the operand size 66 prefix to toggle to a 16-bit operand size. However, setting REX.W takes precedence over the operand size prefix 66H, and that is when both are used. In the case of all of these SIMD instructions, the 66, F2, and F3 prefixes are mandatory for opcode extensions. So what's mandatory for opcode extensions? In such a case, there is no interaction between a valid REX.W prefix and a 66H opcode extension prefix. So see Chapter 2, Instruction Format, to learn more about what they're talking about. And of course, I put a question mark for F2 and F3 just because I know so little about those right now. Okay, so here's the table. You got your L flag. This is completely taking the place of D flag, and I've spent enough time on this. If you want some practice questions, I can post those. I kind of created a template real quick right here. So remember, if there is an L flag set to 1, no matter what, the smallest an address can be is 32 bits. Now, given any of these values, you should be able to determine the size of the operand and the address. So here's the template there. You can fill out any of this stuff you want, and doing so with the chart will give you the ability to answer these two questions. So what I did right here is I put a 0, a yes, and that would give me an operand size of 16 and an address size of 32. Man, in a 64-bit mode, you really can whittle these operands down to 16 bits. That's pretty small numbers. And maybe if you're a scientist doing some scientific calculation, you'd want a processor that can handle some really big numbers. You would then require those operands to be in the 64-bit range like they are over here. Okay, but let's focus on operand addressing now. In a 32 machine, instructions act on 0 or more operands, and some operands are specified explicitly and others are implicit. The data for a source operand can be located in either the instruction itself. We call this an immediate operand. That data could also be in a register, a memory location, so that's on RAM itself, right? Or even an I/O port. And the thing that comes to my mind right away is just if I said the instruction like add, and then I put EAX, so whatever is in EAX right now, let's say it's a number 2, and I add 3 to that, I have a value of 5. And now in EAX is the binary digits that make 5. Oh, and I did a little example over here too. Now the manual says when an instruction returns data to a destination operand, it can be returned to either a register, a memory location, or an I/O port. And that makes a lot of sense in graphics, that is. If you have a monitor for your output, then the results can be returned to that output. And for my example here with 3, that's what is called an immediate operand, that is, this number 3 going to be immediately used. It's not like I'm accessing this number from another register or memory location. So there's a good question. What is an immediate operand? The Intel manual's description of it is some instructions use data encoded in the instruction itself as a source operand. These operands are called immediate operands or simply immediates. For example, the following add instruction adds an immediate value of 14 to the contents of the EAX register. So there you go, right there, just a straight up number. And now we can ask even deeper questions like, where is 14? Like, where's the source of 14? Where is this coming from? My key presses on the keyboard for 1-4? Well, the manual goes on to say that all arithmetic instructions, except the divide or IDIV instructions, allow the source operand to be an immediate value. Okay, so you're allowed to use immediate operands in a lot of different types of instruction, not just addition. However, the maximum value allowed for an immediate operand varies among instructions, but can never be greater than the maximum value of an unsigned double integer. Unsigned being positive, and a double word is 32 bits. As you can see right here with 2 to the 32nd. So there's a think, write, share question. What's the general max a source can have? Okay, now if we're talking register operands, source and destination operands can be any of the following registers depending on the instruction being executed. You can apparently also use the EFLAGS register, and then all the rest of these that we have spent very little time studying so far. But we'll get to that. Right now it says that some instructions, such as the division and multiply instructions, they use quad word operands contained in a pair of 32-bit registers. So you add two registers like this to create 64 bits of a value of an operand. Register pairs are represented with a colon separating them. So just like I did right there, for example, in the register pair, EDX contains the high order bits and EAX contains the low order bits of a quad word operand. Several instructions, such as the push FD and pop FD instructions, are provided to load and store the contents of the EFLAGS register or to set or clear individual flags in this register. Other instructions, such as the JCC instruction, use the state of the status flags in the EFLAGS register as a condition codes for branching or other decision-making operations. Now the processor contains a selection of system registers that are used in control memory management, interrupt and exception handling, task management, process management, and debugging activities. So some of these system registers are accessible by an application program, or the operating system, or the executive through a set of system instructions. So there's a good question, what is an example of a system instruction? When accessing a system register with a system instruction, the register is generally an implied operand of the instruction. Oh, and my little image right here is, I think, a good one to write a question on. What instruction uses the contents of EFLAGS? Well, the jump instruction. Up here it said, EFLAGS is being used as a condition code to figure out when an appropriate time to jump would be. And then as a follow-up, what address would you jump to after the jump occurs? And so we'll get more into the assembly later on. When you see the assembly, you'll understand the program flow that the processor is taking us through. All right, now if we're talking a 64-bit mode, we can use any of these registers. And as a quick reminder, because we studied segmentation, if any of these registers is a zero, then what we're really looking at is a flat memory module. And online, I've read some good debates about whether we should have segmented or flat memory. You should just know that mostly we're using flat memory. And after looking at all these registers, I was wondering if there is some sort of like etiquette, like certain registers should only be used for certain operands, or used as certain operands, I imagine. And I don't think my writing right here is very clear, because what I was thinking is the word operand is the thing you're using to change something else. And that change we call processing, thus we're studying processors. In this case, with this Intel manual, we're studying the x86 architecture of those processors. And so based on the architecture or the design, after an operand is used to change something, that change is the output that we're looking for. Well, that was our section on operand addressing. It dealt a lot less with actual addresses and more with the use of registers to hold values. These values we call operands. And so in the next video, I'll dig deeper into our operand knowledge. I incorrectly put part 17 here. We're actually on part 18 now, and that's on page 85 of the Intel manual. In the next video, I'll talk about how operands are created using a segment selector and offset. And as always, thank you for watching. Let me know if you have any questions or comments.